So thank you very much, Dean, for being with us here today. I'd like to ask your views on three things very quickly. So first, what do you think the qualities of a successful C-suite executive or board member should be in this area, in this era of disruptive technology?
So the strongest recommendation we have for executives who are experiencing this disruption and the speed and complexity of technology changes, AI and machine language, is not to over-delegate it. It can become easy and natural to want to go to an IT organization and lean on them, but underlearn as a leader, whether you're in marketing, finance, or operations. And so we, that is our largest encouragement. The other thing, very briefly, we have a research out that we call productive disruptors. And those are individuals who lead different functions at the top of an organization and who are particularly adept at introducing technology. And we've labeled them productive disruptors. The disrupting part is, as you can guess, they are open and learning oriented and they're willing to challenge the status quo. But the other thing that's interesting, the productive part, the people that do this particularly well are adept at relationships, adept at communications. So they're bringing it all together into what we would call just a more multidisciplinary approach within a given function.
Now, how is artificial intelligence and other disruptive technology transforming corporate governance and corporate social responsibility, in your opinion?
I'm no CSR expert, but I will certainly tell you what I'm seeing, and this includes in the boardrooms in the United States. One is there's an understanding more and more that CEOs need to take the lead in entering into the discussion about the implications for technology in areas such as CSR, to be frankly more provocative in the discussion. I think this is a very useful thing because, in my personal opinion, many of these CEOs got us into a very tricky place. So I'm glad they're focusing on their role in counteracting and putting guardrails on technology. Also, we see an emphasis on purpose and meaning in organizations more and more globally. And I think, again, this is a reaction to, as we go down this road, this hyper-efficiency and all the different ways that technology is applied, how else can we counterbalance it in terms of what are the purpose of organizations, where are we headed, and what do we have to say about it, how can we control it? And briefly, in the States, still this dichotomy we see every day. One day Mark Zuckerberg is testifying in front of Congress and used to be a popular guy, now he's less popular. And then in a good way, we hear Microsoft talking about human rights impact assessments regarding AI and trying to do the right thing there.
And lastly, how do you think we can ensure integrity in a company's management?
So I've had passion about this for a long time across my career. It's, of course, a very important area across the board, across the world, across industries, and across time. And indeed, this is, you know, our Australian colleagues are engaged in a lot of discussions with our banking clients about how to bring back not only true integrity in leadership, but perceptions of integrity in leadership. But the bottom line is, I've been passionate about this. I conducted some research along with Hogan Assessments in the States years ago, around 2002, that I think is still very germane to this question, which is, we actually looked at the psychometric data of people that ended up in prison. And so we tried to understand, at least from a personality perspective, are there any trends in those individuals that certainly one operationalization of integrity problems, not a complete one, is have you broken the law? And so we looked at those individuals, and in short, we saw that they had feelings, more feelings of entitlement than other people. Why can't I go and take what I want? I deserve this, I'm going to aggressively take it, break rules, or ignore rules. And so to us, the precursor of all this is blaming, not taking responsibility, rationalization in an executive. And my main answer to your question is, so we now train our clients to look for blaming and rationalization in interviews, whether a selection or hiring interview, or even a promotion discussion. We see a lot of evidence of that. That gives us a lot of question marks about signs of entitlement that could lead to problems in integrity.
Thank you very much, Dean, for sharing this time with us and your insights.
It was my honor and pleasure. I'm glad to meet you and be here today.